first one. Make it a Deadpool-centric, you know, movie. They said, Rob, should we have Vanessa or should we have Siren? Like, these are the issues that are trying to determine early on. And I said, you not go the Siren route. She has a past with Banshee and all this other stuff. Keep with Vanessa. Vanessa is grounded. That's the relationship you want to go. They asked about villains and nemesis, and of course there wasn't. One thing I've discussed with Marvel over and over again, I tried to course correct. Last summer I did a, this isn't a plug, this is just literally just an example. I did a bat, Marvel came to me and said, you want to do our first ever graphic novel for Deadpool? And I was like, I didn't know, like, a graphic novel, that's like a, I'm a comic book guy, I don't do graphic novels. I was like, is this like a, is this like a way to put me in the cellar? And I said, can I think about it? And I called them back after the week because I talked to every retailer and they said, no, Rob, the graphic novel is a great idea. That's the best thing ever. You should do that. I said, okay. I needed to talk to my peeps. And they said, okay. So I told Marvel, if that's still open, I'll do it. And they're like, yeah, what do you want to do with it? And I said, start giving Deadpool a rogues gallery. Because if you've been reading the Deadpool comics, he fights mostly lame Captain America villains that were introduced in the 70s, the Serpent Society, not the greatest assortment of villains. Also, they can't come into a movie because they're Captain Americas. Marvel has them over in the Disneyland. It's funny, Disneyland. Okay. So, also Taskmaster, an Avengers villain. And then somebody with crack took a Howard the Duck villain called Dr. Bong, and I'm like, what are they doing? Just give him a rogues gallery. Like, this isn't, I made Deadpool, I made Cable, I made Domino, I made 30 characters for you. I can do villains. I can do that. So last summer I started building out villains. So, you know, with the hopes maybe in, you know, 20 years, the guy that I introduced, Thumper, arrives. But the thing is, there wasn't a lot of options for villains. Even when they went to make the sequel, they're like, hey, Rob, there aren't a lot of Deadpool villains. I'm like, surprise! Like, this is what I've been telling Marvel for years. So, you know, they did, but you'll see, they did a great job working around that. But so that's the kind of stuff that I was talking to them in 2009. Then this movie Zombieland came out, which was brilliant. My wife doesn't like horror films, and I dragged her to it, and she's like, okay, this is the greatest, like a horror comedy. Oh my gosh, we're like new to her. She dug it. Obviously, Rhett Reese, Paul Wernick wrote that brilliant movie. They were hired shortly thereafter to write the Deadpool script. I read the Deadpool script, 2010. I love it. I can't believe what I'm reading. It's like Quentin Tarantino wrote a comic book movie. That's how it read on the page. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this movie will be the biggest hit if they make this script right here. And then the years went by. And I'm like, I don't understand why they're not making this. It's cheap, too. It's not like a guy with a glove and multiple jewels and Marvel heroes and a $400 million budget, right? It's a guy with guns on a freeway and motorbikes, and it's grimy and it's crime-oriented. And what do you need? No. I thought you had the tickets. There you go. Have fun. Okay. The thing is, I know what I don't have more than I know what I have. So anyway, the thing is, over the years, as you guys, that's all really well-chronicled history. Finally, they make that footage, and that takes 3 years to leak. But that's when I knew this thing's gonna start. It's gonna take, and then that didn't quite take. But then it did, and you got Deadpool 1, and it was awesome. And I'm gonna tell you right now, I was on set, I watched Deadpool 1 be filmed, we went to every grimy, dirty location in Vancouver. They'd be like, Rob, we're going to a neighborhood that's very, like, unsafe. You need to, like, be on guard. These people will rob you blind. Don't turn that corner without security. And I'm like, this is rad. Like, it's really grimy and dirty and awful. And, you know, there's needles everywhere. So you're like, cool, feels like Deadpool. And so, like, the first movie was, I'm building up to the reason I'm telling you this is because Deadpool 2 happens. And because you guys showed up and kept watching Deadpool. I mean, even I knew that they had a hit on their hands because I've been a student of film my whole life, as much as comics. I have good instincts, as always have in my career. I followed them, but in movies, I watched the dailies when we were on the set of the first one, and I told everybody. Now you understand the movie was being made for $56 million, and I was watching the dailies in the tent, and I said, "Oh gosh, it's gonna be a giant hit! It's gonna be a giant hit!" At that time, no, I think X-Men movie had opened. Like PG-13 X-Men movie had opened like higher than like 80 million or whatever, and I'm watching this and it's R-rated, so I knew this was gonna be R-rated, but I go, you guys, it's gonna open like $85 million. Shut up, Liefeld, you're jinxing us. Shut up, y'all. Shut up, Liefeld. Why do you say that? And I'm like, that's what I think. And I remember at the time, because it was 20 2015 they were filming, and earlier that summer, 2014, there was that dirty teddy bear movie. We will not speak of the sequel to that movie, but the first Ted is genius. And you go, that was a foul-mouthed talking teddy bear that audiences love. They have foul-mouthed superhero. You know, the thing about Ryan is he made Deadpool dirty. I mean, like, Marvel Comics, he's never dropping those F-bombs, right? But good God almighty, you'll get to 100 in 5 minutes in this movie. Just start counting F-bombs, and you'll be like, all right, I'm out. I'm at 200 F-bombs, and it's at the 20-minute mark. So, you know, and I love that Ryan made it R-rated. I love that it got more adult and more, but again, like, I'm just giving credit where credit is due. The only time I think Deadpool scratched that surface was with the Deadpool Max series that they did in, like, 2010, 2011. But for the most part, you know, the great thing about Deadpool is he's also cute and cuddly. You can go buy pops of him all day long in Hot Topic, and he's cute and cuddly, and kids love him. And then you come here, and he's filthy and dirty. It's awesome. No character has that much spectrum. I tell one of my daughter's teachers told her that Deadpool was from the devil last year. And we pulled her out of that school. Because, yeah, that's not cool. That's my daughter. I'm the Deadpool guy. And we pulled her out. And I said, babe, the only Deadpool that we ever kind of have to apologize to our conservative friends is the dirty one, is the movie, the R-rated one. Otherwise, let's go to the store and we can get the cute and cuddly Deadpool all day long. But I love the wide spectrum of Deadpool, and honestly, he's now a global, worldwide phenomenon because of Ryan Reynolds. Ryan Reynolds, period, in the story, he's a genius. He is this character. When people say he's really the same, Deadpool is Ryan Reynolds. Ryan Reynolds is Deadpool. Trust me, I've been there. I fear his tongue turning on me. I'm like, don't start. Because he's so, that wit, these jokes that you're going to see, and some of them he would rewrite 5 weeks before production. I know because Stefan, who plays Colossus, would say, Rob, Ryan called me in the middle of night last night. He talks on this for real. And we ran new lines. I record new lines for Deadpool, changing all the time. And I know for a fact, Ryan is always, he wakes up and he goes, that joke would work better. And, you know, up until the end of production, he was putting them in. Now, I know they actually, I didn't know if I could actually say that, but then I was reading about it because I swear, the internet, everything's out there now. Avoid spoilers as much as you can on everything. That's my motto. But Deadpool 2, you guys go see it. It becomes a giant hit. They're going to make a second sequel. They make the mistake of committing to Cable at the end of that last movie. When he comes out and he goes, and next time we're bringing Cable, and it's like, gotcha. They can't get out of that. You can't have a movie that hit $100 million and tell those people that you're not bringing Cable because you already bought Cable. So then we went on a year and a half long search for Cable. And I'm going to tell you right now, I can't say the names, but you have no idea. Every actor, it was funny, even 35-year-old actors were like, hey, I can be Cable. I'm like, you're too young. No. And even producers like, Rob, you can't. These young kids are like, I'm Cable. I'm like, if you ever read the comic, all they know is Deadpool said Cable, so I can be Cable. No. You've got to go read the comic. Older guy. Some of the guys you were talking to were great. I got to know a couple of guys who were in the running. You know, for whatever reason, they didn't make the cut. And then there was a couple guys, I swear to you, I would have shot myself if they had been cast as Cable. I was like, honey, I'm going to end it all. If this dude is cast as Cable, I'm jumping off the highest building in Los Angeles. It'll make news. At least, you know, you'll know I died for a purpose. I can't handle that dude as Cable. And then Josh Brolin saved the day. They cast one of the best actors of all time. And, I mean, I've grown up with Josh. He is obviously so ridiculously talented, from Sicario to No Country for Old Men to even when he's a supporting character like he is in so many films. The one, what's the other Coen brothers? It's a remake. John Wayne, help me out. Jeff Bridges, little girl.
The Grit. True Grit.
Even in a bit part, Josh stands out. He's so good. So when we got Josh, I was like, oh my gosh, this movie's going to be great. Because, again, I believe you got to win these battles in casting, you know? And obviously, Zazie Beetz, that's how you say her name. You gotta have a nice Zazie. So if you're saying Zazie, you're saying it wrong. She told me herself. So she's fantastic as Domino. I just thought, like, they needed somebody to hold their ground with Ryan. And you understand, and Josh, and everybody. And she, if you haven't seen the movie, I've been out there, very honest, I think she steals the whole movie. I think she is the secret MVP of this film. She's phenomenal. She's super talented, super charming, and I think she has some of the best scenes in the entire movie. And I mean, at that point, you know, again, Domino, Deadpool, and Cable were wished onto the page by young Rob Liefeld, who was desperate, broke, and had to compete with Wolverine and Spider-Man. I had my peer group had the sweet toys. They had Wolverine, most popular character in Marvel for 30 years, and Spider-Man, most popular character ever. And I'm like, the New Mutants, what do I got? I got nothing. I got a bunch of kids. who are dressed in bad 80s clothes. What am I doing here? And the editors just let me go. Cable, I introduced Cable in Newman's 87. That book sold 125,000 copies. Prior to my coming on, it was selling 100. And then over the course of 1 year, you guys, I'm very proud of this. That's why I say it. It's something that, you know, isn't celebrated enough. Marvel backed me up. Within 1 year, we added 700,000 sales because people started clamoring for Cable. Obviously, they gave me the full reins to do all the story and all the art, and I introduced the man called Deadpool, the woman called Domino, and our good friend Gideon, who just, it didn't happen for him. But 2 out of 3 on that. People always tell me, they, people even today, Rob, did you think Deadpool was going to be a big success? Here's what I tell them. If the character is on the cover, standing like this, or like Cable with his gun here, if he's on the cover, that's a message. I'm going to connect with you. I am an important character. Not all the characters that I've introduced do that. When he was first introduced, Shatterstar, not in, on the cover of the book. I thought maybe he'd be good, but Deadpool, Domino, Cable, if they're on the cover, in it, they're being announced. They're being announced. It's kind of like they're coming, they're important. Deadpool became so popular that they made me, really, I mean, I work for Marvel, and they said, Rob, we've never gotten this much mail on one character in 15 years. The mail on Deadpool after meeting Sunday is crazy. And look, here's the thing, I tell people, when I was a kid, when I was 9 years old, okay, check this out. 41 years ago today, little Robbie Liefeld went to the Cineplex and saw Star Wars. 9 years old, my mind, just go watch Logan's Run. That came out the summer before. That is where special effects were at before George Lucas said, let me show you what I can do. And I remember going, I remember sitting where you are and watching this theater. And that it's not a big deal now, but when that Star Destroyer just kept coming over the crawl, you're like, what's that? And then you understand, in Logan's Run, in the comics, when they did the comic adaptation, it looked like good lasers. To this day, I know you're like, what are you talking about, Logan's Run? It's about Deadpool. No, it's about whatever I want to say. So Logan's Run, in that, Logan whoops at his gun, and he goes, stop! And these flames come out of the gun. And then there's a time squib behind the guy he's shooting at, and he goes, poof! And he's like, whoa! There's not even a Star Trek, like, phaser beam? Like a cheapest special effect you ever saw. Like, you're like, the state of science fiction in Hollywood is crap in 1976. 1 year later, C-3PO and R2-D2 go across that hallway, and there's all those pellets, and if you were 9 in 1977, you're like, what am I seeing? Holy crap! So anyway, that was 41 years ago today. That is just absolutely nuts and crazy, but it affected me. It affected my love for comics, it affected my love for film, and you saw what was possible and what we were capable of. And I cannot believe, like, again, we got to a sequel with Deadpool. Like, I could not believe that, and I couldn't believe that it went so well. And here's one thing you can't even begin to understand is they did it really fast. As you sit here, realize this is 2018. Deadpool came out in 2016. In 2 calendar years, they gave you the sequel. That's not heard of. Like, even Captain America from 1 to 2 is about 3.5 years. Guardians of the Galaxy, number 1 to 2 is 3 years. Like, 2 years, and this was crazy because Fox obviously said, people love this, they want this. Ryan wanted to give you a sequel in the worst ways. And again, getting the right people, lining them up, and making this film. And when I got to Vancouver this time, going back to what I said earlier about the cheap, dark, the needles on the streets of Vancouver, it was so rad. You're like, we are in this dingy world. The best thing they did in the first one is they closed down the freeway for 2 weeks. All that 12 bullets and all that stuff was the biggest kind of production cost on the first one. I get off the plane, and so you might have read about this, but when you get off the plane and there's someone waiting for you, they have your name, but then they always sometimes, especially with the movie, they have a production banner. The name for this movie, the secret code name in Vancouver was Love Machine. So when you got off the plane and there was something that said Rob Liefeld Love Machine, you're like, yeah, we're going to set a Love Machine. Love Machine's going to be the best movie ever. Love Machine stars Josh Brolin and Ryan Reynolds. So we're driving, and this time we're not going through those streets. We're going to like the swankier part of Vancouver, and suddenly we pull up on this lot, and there's 2 giant airport hangars. These are sound stages. And I went, oh my God, we have money for sound stages. Like, we have a budget this time. Like, there's a budget on this movie. And then I go into the sound stages, and literally it was rad. There was one long hallway that separated A from B, and in both sound stages were 2 sets each that were shooting pretty much simultaneously, either second unit some pickup action or actual, you know, live action stuff that David Leitch was directing every day. And so it was just like a, it was for me like an amusement park. Like it was like when we landed.
And to all the families that landed in Orlando tonight, enjoy your resorts. Enjoy the amusement parks.
I'm like, screw that. Go to Deadpool 2. That's an adult amusement park. I'm through this door. Hey, Josh, how you doing? Oh, crap, you look like Cable. Oh, through this door. Hey, Zezzy, you look like Domino. And then there's Ryan over all of it, and it's fantastic. And when I was on the set, I knew that they had something special. I knew, like, it's we're pulling it off because David Leitch is one of the best directors working in Hollywood right now. He's fantastic. Started out as a stunt guy. He and his partner started one of the biggest stunt I think it's called 7711 or 2711, their stunt company in Los Angeles. They started out doing stunts for Matrix, and they started out doing Brad Pitt stunts and Matt Damon stunts. And then, of course, the two guys got into directing, gave you John Wick 2, gave you Atomic Blonde. And then David got the reins for this, and I knew we were in great shape because he shoots things so brilliantly. I don't know how you guys do with movies, but a lot of times I pause it. I study shots when I get them on Blu-ray, and I'm like, there's 100 shots in this movie that I just want to freeze and look at. And I mean, it's, oh, to bring Cable to life, to bring Josh Brolin to life is just phenomenal. And to bring, you know, Domino, this entire world. And so when I was on the set, I was like, okay, I think it's going to work out good. It's going to be fun. Everyone's having a good time. And then in February, David invited me up to the Fox lot to watch a cut of the movie. And I'm going to tell you, I was nervous. Because let's be honest, man. Deadpool 2 doesn't do well in today's society, in today's world. It was a one-hit wonder. It was a fluke. Deadpool would have been a fluke. The Deadpool pipeline would have been choked off. No more. Sequel's important, man. You got, like, people just, this immediate age of, no good. You're either a winner or a loser in today's society. There's no in between. There's no kind of. You're not kind of. You're either a winner or a loser. I don't believe that, but that's how they judge things. So I'm like, oh, boy, I hope this works. So I sat down, and I'm telling you, 5 minutes into it, and I already knew how many times I'd see it on the press circuit, and like, this is going to be my eighth time seeing it tonight. I was like, oh yeah, I'm buying tickets to see this like 3 times, easy, because at the like 10 minute mark, I'm like, I have to see that again. There's so many things to watch in this movie, so many things, if you blink, you're going to miss it, and that's when they do, you got to come back and see it again. Which, back to Star Wars, me and my friends, as kids, the cantina scene, that was a lot more complicated in 1977 when you were 9. Now you look at me, oh, it's not that big of a deal. Back there was a big deal. So packed with information. And me and my friend who goes to Star Wars again, go, we're going to look at the right side of the screen this time. Everyone look at the right. Okay, next time, the left. Okay, this time, folks on the center. We got to take in all these characters. In this movie, there's stuff you're going to miss, and you're going to be like, and you're going to laugh at joke number one, and you're going to miss the other 2 jokes. Because they jam this thing. It's tight. It's tight with action, with Easter eggs. I know, like, I haven't clicked yet. I know online they're like, all the Easter eggs in Deadpool. I do not need to know that if I click on that, I know that they miss 5. Oh, they miss 5. Easy. Or more. There's so much packed in this movie. So I sat with David, I watched it, and that's when I was like, oh yeah, this movie can't come out fast enough. And it had already been testing through the roof. And it's also the first time that I actually encountered, like, some guy online, and we can talk about this now, some guy with 10 followers, this is the internet now, went online and said, Deadpool is getting bad reviews and the audiences hate it. And I'm like, that's a lie, that's a lie. I've seen the movie and I've already seen the scores. That guy's lying. But the internet picked up on it. And all we get on, Deadpool in trouble, Deadpool 2 in trouble. And I'm like, okay, first, if I can hunt this guy down and hurt him, I will. Because he's lying. And then you go to his avatar, and he had characters from another universe entirely. And you're like, oh, maybe you kind of worship this other world. That's the one we live in. It's hurt the other guy. I hate it. It's crazy. I'm not crazy, though. So, although I feel crazy. But the thing is that I was just like, I'm not even going to let this bother me. This movie can't be stopped. They did such a good job. And talking to the guy who was broke, needed these characters to work, needed the sales to go up. There's nothing like there's nothing like desperation to spur creativity. And again, when they told me, Rob, you got to move this up and put Deadpool in issue 2 of X-Force, because you can't, I know you have him coming in issue six, you have to get him up. The demand is there, and that's great. I tell people, the fans have always delivered Deadpool and Cable. They've always stepped up, because again, you understand. When X-Force number one shipped and sold 5 million copies, second best-selling comic of all time, those characters had been around for 19 months. And I remember my good friend, some of you guys are hardcore comic fans, you know Todd McFarlane. I'd say, Todd, what do you think? You think X-Force is going to sell well? You sold 3 million Spider-Mans. But, what the F is an X-Force? I don't know what that is. You'll be lucky to sell 500,000. Okay. And I was like, So then X4 sold 5 million, and I'm like, yeah, I don't want to talk to Todd for like a couple weeks either. Because he's like, my record doesn't stand no more. And then we all knew Jim was coming with the X-Men to sit on our face. So, you know, like, what does that mean? But, like, I wedged right in there. And you guys understand, in 1991, what wedged right in there? A bunch of characters that did not exist 19 months. Now, you're getting the 22-year-old Rob Liefeld, who's coming back and embodying me and feeling a little bit of the pride. Because, like I said, man, that was out of necessity, and I had to compete. And Todd would be like, fuck you. You're drawing a team book. I'm drawing Spidey. I'm done already. When we get off the phone, I'm done. You'll be drawing for 10 hours. He's nuts on other. And he's smart. He went from one mass character to another mass character. It's fun. And I can't wait till you guys upload this and he sees my invitation because he, that always entertains him not. So how much time do I have? Am I good? Because I'm a fast talker. 10 minutes. I can keep talking. So here's the deal. So it's funny because, you know, when I was on the set, I'd take all these pictures with Josh, and then Fox is like, yeah, you can't put this up. Josh has a green sleeve on, and we can't allow the green sleeve to be seen. Like there's a reason we don't want people to see that he has a green sleeve on, and because that's going to be a cybernetic arm, obviously that's why it's green. And I'm like, well, that sucks. And then they totally did me a solid. There was a photographer on set who had been taking a bunch of pictures of me and Josh, and then they were like, here's one shot that we got from his other side of the obscurity. This up. I didn't want to put it up like to, you know, oh, I'm important. I wanted to share with you guys how awesome he looked. But again, man, you know, you got to tiptoe around those sets because everything, like they'd be like, you can take as many pictures as you want, but if you ever air these, we will sue you in the ground and you will own your family for 100 years. I got it. They're super nice, you know, bringing me to the set and letting me hang out with all the actors and letting me interact with these creations who've come to life. And one thing I will tell you, though, you're going to see some stuff in this movie. And again, in terms of reshoots, you guys all have to rethink how you think. I feel like I'm one of you guys. I consume news. I consume pop culture. And people think of reshoots in the worst possible light. Some of the favorite stuff you're going to see tonight is stuff they did in reshoots over about a 10-day period. And the reason is the audience, Fox already had a movie that they knew you liked. They listened to when they get the feedback process. They do a consumer test group with 25 of you who were at the screening. They'll pull you and test you and ask you what you liked and didn't like. Everybody said we wanted more Cable and Domino. And so they said, we're going to give people what they want. So they went back and they gave more Cable and more Domino. Now, I know what the stuff is, but I don't want to spoil it because it's when you know too much. But I'm like, those were good additions. Every addition in this movie improved it because it gave you more of what you already liked. And they already knew, like, this is what people like. And here's the thing, these studios want to give product that people enjoy and like because they know nowadays, because I have three teenagers, and to get them off their iPads and watching Netflix is like moving a planet. They're like, no, I'm good, I'm watching this movie on my phone. On a phone? I have three teenagers. But now I've come to accept, you're going to watch some of the greatest stuff ever made in cinema on your phone. It's just, don't fight it, it's just the way it is. Don't come into the 100-screen room, kids, and watch TV with Mom and I, because you want to watch it on your 2-inch screen. I get it. Crazy pants. But, you know, to get them to theaters is hard. I've seen it. You know, at least I have one film junkie son who's totally into this. And I will wrap up by telling you this. This is the best. And I was able to tell my buddy Kevin Feige, who runs Marvel Comics, at Marvel Film Empire, at the Black Panther premiere, because Fox had moved the date on this movie in front of Memorial Day. And I thought it was a really great movie because they got like two opening weekends out of it. You got last week and then this long holiday weekend. And my son, who I took to see Iron Man when he was 8 years old. So 2008, he was born in 2000, so whatever the years he is. So 2008, he's 8, I take him to see Iron Man, blows his mind, loves it. So he has watched every Marvel film, he loves them, he is a huge fan. Also loves Deadpool, but comes down with his laptop the afternoon that they announced their movie. And if I embody his voice and he sounds like Napoleon Dynamite, that's what he sounds like. Dad, comes down the stairs, and he's holding his laptop. Dad, and my wife and I are on the couch. Oh, okay, what's up, Luke, what's up? Dad, this is a terrible mistake you're making. I said, what is the mistake I'm making? Moving Deadpool so close to Infinity War. This is a terrible mistake.
I said, I can't do anything about it. I didn't do it. It'll be fine, relax. Like, both movies are gonna do fine.
But Infinity War is the
saga of my generation, Dad. It is the saga of my generation. And I'm like, you know, I looked at my wife, and I'm like, it's true. He's seen 1,500 of these Marvel movies. He's invested in every chapter. So he's like, Dad, you're going to get wiped out by Thanos. I'm like, everyone's getting wiped out by Thanos. Don't worry. And so I just thought that was funny because, like, he was saying, Dad, but it obviously worked out for everybody because we both have the magic of Josh Brolin, who somehow is a purple testicle in one movie. An awesome, badass, cybernetic soldier from the future, right? No, come on. Josh, I could not believe when they cast Josh Brolin, I thought, okay, we got Josh Brolin. He's one of the best actors, I've already said. What I didn't expect was to see him at the gym 3 times a day, become and ripped his crap. I mean, like, I would watch, oh my gosh, and then we met, and I'm like, dude, his vein, in one of my pictures I put online, it looks like they taped the vein on. It's like a python sliding down his, I'm like, that, and unfortunately, the first time I met him, I didn't speak to him. I got caught up, and I just touched him. I was like, wow, look at that vein. And I'm like, oh crap, I didn't even say hi. I'm touching Josh Brolin's buff arm vein. And he's like, I think he was like, you're funny to me. I think he thinks like you're the funny comic book guy, like hyperactive weirdo that we're tolerating on set. So no, it's, I mean, the fact that both movies have Brolin is nothing short of fantastic. And but when I did, I'll end with this. One of the bloggers who interviewed me said, Rob, it was two weeks ago. Said, what did you think when you came out of Deadpool the first time I saw it in that screening? And I said, I thought everyone's gonna have a party. This movie is a party. It's a great time. You're gonna leave with a big smile on your face. If you haven't already, and the thing is, like, I knew that Infinity War would devastate us. Like, it was coming like a tidal wave to wipe us out. I didn't expect to be confused. Oh crap! I was devastated and confused in Infinity War. I was like, what did I just see? And I kept telling myself, hey, tell me what I saw. And then I would go to my friend Jeff Loeb, who's head of Marvel Television. I say, what? Funniest thing is, ask somebody where they think Thanos is at the end of Infinity War. 10 answers. You'll get 10 answers because nobody knows. You want to know what Jeff Loeb told me? And I don't care if this is on tape. Jeff Loeb, what do you mean, where is he? He's in Wakanda. He's in a jungle in a cabin. I'm like, that's not Wakanda. Talk to you later. So the confusion and the devastation of Infinity War has led us to Deadpool, where you're going to have just a great time. It's got a better soundtrack. Just kidding. I don't care the soundtrack on Infinity War. But come on, we have air supply, okay? We win.
Yes.
And our commercials had LL Cool J. Come on. I'm just kidding. There is no competition. They're all Marvel. They're all doing great. Thank you for showing up for this. I just want to give you a little... I don't know that anything I said was cohesive or made sense, but I know that I talked to you, and I gave you some of what I experienced. And like I said, the end of this is the first premiere of Deadpool 1, like in New York, was in a theater that was so small and had, like, it was so tiny, again, because Fox didn't know what they had. They're managing it carefully, you know? And so when we pull up in New York 2 weeks ago, my family and I, and we go to the premiere in New York, I'm like, oh, wow, this is a big deal now! Like, this is a big... And in LA, the biggest building on the 405, which is the biggest freeway, has this Deadpool with his arms crossed, and you can see it online. It is 100 miles high and 100 miles wide. And when I get home and land in LAX, and I drive home, I'll pass him with his arms out to me, looking like Christ. Remind everyone that he is now God of all. It's awesome. You're like, we got a budget now. It's not just a movie. We got a budget on everything. You know, like, so it's awesome. It's just an awesome experience. They stuck the landing on the first one. They stuck the landing on this one. And trust me, I had the most to lose. If Deadpool 2 sucked, people go, Life, look, you would support it. No, I wouldn't. I'd have just been quiet. I'd just been like, how'd you like it? Go back to Wolverine Origins. Nice start, right? That I memorized that. I got that down. People go, Life, what would you think? It was just a start. I tried to keep it positive and brief. It's a start. They're making a Deadpool movie. Yeah, it's a nice start. Which was a lie, but I was like, I gotta do something minimal. Say the minimal possible. It's a nice start. Bye. It's a nice start. Oh, Wolverine Origins. Nice start. Oh, it's a nice start. I know it wasn't. I'm just lying. But it's a nice start. 4 words I memorized. I committed to. And then 2016, I didn't have to say that anymore because Deadpool is here. And now Deadpool 2 is here, and it's great. And I've already said that 14 times, right? Fox didn't pay me to say that.
You can say it again.
I just said it. I think you're going to have a great time. So I am now going to go with the same talk to the other theater. Then I'm going to fall down and collapse. I've seen this movie 8 times. I'd see it 18 because it's a blast. You're going to have a great time. It looks phenomenal. And the jokes, remember, you're going to miss 3 of them. You're gonna miss every time. You're gonna miss the third. Okay, I'm gonna take my magic bag. I'm gonna take my magic propel water, and I'm gonna leave the theater so you can start the movie. But thank you for coming and being a part of this. And this is only the fourth talk I've ever given, and I don't know that I'll make it through a fifth. You may hear that I fell down in the end of the theater. I'm not sure because I'm a little weak, little wobbly. But thank you for coming. Enjoy this. I'll probably see you when it's over, and we can high five, or you can tell me that you didn't like the movie, and then I'll fight you. Because that's not true. Hey, good seeing you. Guys, like I said earlier, you've always supported him, you've always carried him, and now he's getting so big his head's getting a little big. We gotta watch it.
Thank you.
Thanks guys, have
Thank
fun.
You.